Welcome to the 4th Congressional District Candidates Forum. My name is Marguerite Reinberger. This forum is sponsored by the Stillwater Gazette. In alphabetical order, the three candidates running for this office are Dave Thomas, Betty McCollum, and Sharna Walgren. Now, Dave Thomas has not yet arrived. He did RSVP that he would be arriving, so if he shows, both the other candidates graciously said to allow him an opening, and then we'll continue on with the questions. During this 60-minute forum, each candidate will be invited to give up a 1.5-minute opening, a 1.5-minute closing, and up to 2 minutes for responses to my questions. The Stillwater Gazette has provided all of the questions. Carly Johnson will be the timekeeper. She'll hold up cards that say 45 seconds, 15 seconds, and stop. She does have my permission to yell stop when you go beyond the sentence that you're in when that sign goes up. We have a good crowd here tonight, so I'm going to ask if you would please save your approval or disapproval for the polls so we can ask more questions. And the order of who goes first was determined by reverse alphabetical order, which means that Sharna Walgren will go first on the opening, closing, and then opening first question, and then last on the closing. And then if the other candidate shows, we'll adjust accordingly here. Okay, let's begin with 1.5-minute openings. Sharna.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Sharna Walgren, and I want to start by saying thanks to the Stillwater Gazette for hosting this event, to Margot for moderating it, for my fellow candidate, I was hoping we'd have two, and I still do, for being here and participating tonight, and most importantly for the audience, everyone for coming this evening. I can't tell you how energizing it is to see so many people who want to be informed. I may be a new voice for many of you, but I'm not new to our community. I grew up on the east side of St. Paul. I have a law degree and an economics degree from the University of Minnesota. I practiced law for 20 years right here in our community, and I've always been involved, serving our community in many ways. I'm grateful for the opportunity to participate in this forum tonight, which will help everyone learn about our choices that we all have on November 4th. I also want people to know up front that the Stillwater Gazette has already endorsed Representative Betty McCollum before we had the forum here tonight. According to the Gazette, I'm well qualified, I have a lot of energy, I'm a quick learner, and I am more focused on the future than attacking Representative McCollum. But they said I fall short in one area. I am not a career politician. Well, I can agree that they got the facts right about me, and in the newspaper business, that's important. So look, I'm running for Congress because, like most people, I'm disappointed by what's going on there, and perhaps more importantly, by what's not getting done there. We can do better. I know we can.
Thank you. Betty.
Good evening, I'm Betty, and it's my honor to be working for the families of the 4th Congressional District in the U.S. House, and I would like to thank the Stillwater Gazette as well for hosting tonight's debate, and I do appreciate the Gazette's very kind endorsement of my campaign for re-election. Margo, thank you for moderating tonight and for everybody else involved in making this production happen. I also want to thank Ms. Walgren and Mr. Thomas if he does come, but most importantly, thanking them for the opportunity that we will be able to have with the voters to discuss these important issues. In Congress, my priority is to keep Minnesota communities and families safe, secure, and successful. And that's why I'm running for re-election. I'm asking to earn your vote on November 4th. You deserve to know my positions on some important issues. So for seniors and people living with disabilities, I will continue to protect and strengthen Medicare, Social Security, not privatize them. We need to grow our economy and create good jobs by rebuilding America's infrastructure, expanding clean energy development, and making higher education more affordable for our students. I support pay equity because working women deserve fair pay for their work. And for working parents, we need to work to make childcare more affordable. I support comprehensive immigration reform, and climate change is real and it requires action. I'm pro-choice and I support family planning. Finally, Congress needs to move forward in passing some common sense gun laws that will protect our children and our communities. Thank you.
Thank you. And I will allow rebuttal if requested and if I decide that I think it should be done during the question period. And I'll begin the first question with Sharna.
Margo, I think that Dave Thomas arrived during our openings.
Oh, hi. Hi. Dave, your colleague candidates have requested that you be allowed to do an opening. So if you have your opening or a minute and a half, they thought that would be very fair.
Okay, thank you. Hello, everybody. My name is Dave Thomas. Sorry about the tardiness. I'm the Independence Party candidate for U.S. Congress here in CD4. I am running on a platform for tuition-free universities is the goal. My plan enables the states to take the control of their education systems for themselves. And in doing so, my plan is to remove the federal government from student loan funding and to administer student loan forgiveness. And it's a pretty big policy, and I can go into the meat and potatoes of it as we go on. But those are my big pushes. I have several others. A big reason I'm running and I'm choosing to run is because I'm very frustrated with the dysfunction in Congress. I find that it's holding us all back, and us doing nothing at this time when we really need to be working together and focusing on the future is a step backwards. And so my big push is a functioning Congress. I think if we can send soldiers to war, the least we can do is show up for our job and do our job when we're asked to do it. And that's about it. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, thanks. Yeah, let me know when you're ready, when you're done with your questions, nod or thank me or whatever, because I had one time where there was this big pause and I went on and he said, "But I'm not done yet." And I looked at my watch and I said, "Yes, you are," because it was way too long of a pause. Okay, Sharna, first question. From up to 2 minutes. From a congressional perspective, what suggestions do you have for addressing the ever-concerning Ebola problem?
Thank you for that question. You know, I, for one, wasn't as concerned about our preparedness for it. I trust our government. I trust the CDC. They were coming out saying, we're prepared. Almost any hospital can handle this. But look what happened. We have our first patient. We already have two nurses, two healthcare providers who are already infected with Ebola themselves. And it turns out that the head of the CDC probably wasn't as knowledgeable or prepared as he needed to be. So now I feel like it's a little bit akin to what we saw with Hurricane Katrina. Remember that, where it was coming and we thought we were prepared, and then when it comes here, we realize we're not prepared. So I think what we need to do in this case is make sure that we hurry up and get prepared. One thing that we don't have that we should have had is a Surgeon General. I think at a time like this, the country needs to look at a qualified professional who can talk to a concerned populace as almost a patient and say, listen, here's the informed, educated medical perspective and what we can do. And so we don't have that, and that's a failing of Congress not to have a person in place, a permanent Surgeon General. But I don't think the czar that was just appointed is really necessary. That's another bureaucrat. We need some medical competent advice, and I think at this point the CDC needs to do everything it can to ensure that we truly are prepared, that we're learning quickly, that we're putting proper protocols into place, and that the public can be assured that we will be safe and that the healthcare industry as a whole knows what to do. But this first case where we have two nurses right away, two healthcare professionals infected themselves, and then where do we find others? On a plane? On a ship? Come on, we can do better than that.
Thank you. Betty.
Well, I would agree. It would be wonderful if the Senate could get its job done in a bipartisan fashion and the United States of America had a Surgeon General. That's not an issue for the House, but I have to agree that the Senate should get the confirmation done. I'm very pleased, as my role on being the Appropriation Defense Committee, that I, along with Karen Bass, really, really pushed to get the $88 million that the Department of Defense and others are using to fight Ebola. As Dr. Osterholm put it, it's like a wildfire, and then these embers come out, and the embers are what we saw in Texas. And so we need to put out the full forest fire. So the people going over from the Department of Defense that are working on engineering, working on lab technicians to train people and everything, they're really going to help with the forest fire. The CDC needs to be asked into a state. So the hospital in Texas, I think we're all aware that they made a few big, big mistakes in the way that they logged the patient in. They didn't share information, and then they didn't ask the CDC in as fast as I would have liked. So the CDC has really told the hospitals, we're ready to go. We're ready to come in. And they are updating their protocols as they find events changing. But one of the things we can't do is we can't cut the funding to the Institute of Health. And with sequestration, with some of the other things that have been happening, in particular the House of Representatives, we've had cuts to the NIH. And if sequestration comes back, it's going to be a straight across the board cut. So I've been having meetings with the Department of Defense. I've been having meetings with the State State Department, with USAID, and with my co-chair, Mr. Reichert, a Republican from the West Coast, with the Global Health Caucus. We have been working to inform members of Congress on what we need to do to protect not only people here from the embers that could come across the ocean, but what we need to do to put out the forest fire of Ebola.
Thank you. Dave.
I do feel that Ebola is a very terrifying issue that should be addressed, and I'm glad to see that we're all in agreement that I'm also frustrated that we have no Surgeon General when we should have a person who's at a leadership position to truly lead us in times like this. But what I do realize is if we want to maintain a true free and open market, plagues are going to happen, and it is only a matter of time. So while we should have plenty of safeguards in place and really training and repetition of training to teach nurses and other healthcare providers how to deal with this, what we should focus on are also the repercussions of if such a thing does happen. And when I talk about that, one thing I like to focus on is our agricultural subsidies, which sounds weird to connect the two, but if we do have a serious major plague and our entire agricultural system relies upon hybrid seeds, we are in serious trouble with our food supply. Not only that, is once then, because we're so entangled with corn, that we now have a food supply that cuts in with our fuel supply. So I'd like to see, as part of not only a safeguard within the medical system, but safeguards within what could happen afterwards to this nation, and how can we prevent major catastrophe and move forward from such an event if it were to occur, which, I mean, if we are a nation long enough, there will be a plague that goes through this country that will kill a lot of people. We must understand that, and we can try to do everything we can to stop it, but we need to have a series of programs in place for when such an event does occur.
Thank you. I'll begin the next question with Betty. Should Congress reduce the corporate tax rates to help prevent corporate tax inversions?
Congress needs to do meaningful tax reform. And Dave Camp, a Republican member from Michigan, and Senator Baucus had a roadshow going around. And they even stopped here at 3M and talked to the corporations here about what meaningful tax reform would look like. And so we need to get rid of some of these tax loopholes. We need to modernize our tax credits so that they reflect clean, renewable energies and not fossil fuels that are doing very, very well with their profitability. So there's an opportunity just in energy to work on tax reform. The other area in which we should be focusing on tax reform is how do we make the middle class more secure? How do we make people be able to afford childcare, be able to send a child to college, even go back and do some workforce training themselves as adults, afford a home? So we need a tax system that is fair, that is equitable, and doesn't put a burden on the middle class the way the current tax reform has. But we do need to focus on our business taxes as well.
Thank you. I wanted to remind the audience to please keep your whispers like non-existent, and we can get this done. And I was at a forum a couple weeks ago where there was a lot of whispering going on. It was very distracting to the candidates as well as to those who were attended. So thank you. Dave.
I too feel that we need major tax reform at the federal level. I think that as far as Congress and the federal government is concerned, we should focus on a specific type of tax, and I would just judge that as income tax. We shouldn't have other things such as tariffs and stuff. When we do judge income tax, though, we should be judging it. We should follow the money and not the individuals. And a lot of our court cases have been about turning corporations into individuals and such, but why don't we focus on the dollar amounts? My plan, which would take both houses of Congress an immense amount of working together to implement, would be that we actually do follow the money and we use the previous year's tax returns to base upon the next year's taxes. And we judge it based upon total amount of income produced. So that if somebody's producing 17% of the income in a region, they should be paying out 17% of the tax burden of that region. It's a fair and even way to do it, and we don't have this backwards taxing of corporations getting tax breaks and then not paying workers, workers having to go to the state to get welfare, which is in turn truly a corporate welfare, because if the corporations and businesses were paying real wages, people wouldn't have to come to the government to get welfare. I'm a person who believes that people want to work. I think the vast majority of Americans want to work and they want to do well at their job. We just want an ability to move forward and for everybody to be able to make the American dream, to make the middle class, to maybe get up to the upper class if you weren't in there already. These are things that I want to see for the country, and a large portion of my platform is about that, which includes my student aid plans.
Thank you. Sharna.
Well, I think we're in agreement here tonight that we need some serious tax reform. And that's nice to hear, because I think it's always the first hurdle to realize that we want the same thing. It's frustrating to watch Congress year after year not get it done. So I think part of the message here tonight is if that's what we all want and we all see the need for it and it's not getting done, we need to send someone new to Washington to get that job done. It makes perfect sense to have a flatter tax with fewer loopholes. I wouldn't exchange one set of loopholes for a different set of loopholes, whether you go from a certain kind of energy to a different kind of energy. I think we simply need to reduce those loopholes for everybody. So we've got a fair tax that's being applied equally. So the government's not already choosing winners or losers, deciding who to support and who not to, who's going to succeed and who isn't. We need to eliminate all of that for a number of reasons. You know, we, as Americans, spend an amazing amount of time and money filing tax returns every year. It's something like 6 billion hours of time every year and $300 billion a year. It equates to 8,700 lifetimes worth of time every year. Not years, lifetimes. That's an enormous waste of our intellectual resources and time. We could do far better with that, and we could do it with a much simpler tax code that's fair. So we don't have some corporations paying all this and some paying none. We all know the trouble with GE paying virtually no taxes because of loopholes. And instead, we have other corporations paying a lot more. If we could equalize it so everybody paid their fair share, the same amount on the same playing field, the tax rates actually could be lower. We could fill out our tax returns, perhaps not in a postcard, but in a lot simpler manner. You know, our tax code has something like 4 million words. Talk about Obamacare, where people didn't read it first. Nobody knows what's in this tax code. It simply is too complex, and I think we all agree on that. So I'd be in favor of that, something that's fair for everybody, and I think we just need to get that done.
Thank you, Betty. Would you like an extra minute?
Well, I would just say that one of the things that's currently going on in Congress right now is not doing a comprehensive tax reform package and picking winners and losers with tax extenders and making these tax extenders permanent. So they never come up for review. And we're not doing the balance about what does this mean for middle class families? Where's their permanency in their tax reduction? So we need to do reform, but we need to do it right so the middle class benefits.
Thank you. I'll begin the next question with Dave. The federal government will see another debt ceiling decision again in 2015. If in Washington, how will you vote and why?
I would not vote to not extend the debt ceiling. I think that's really political shenanigans on an issue that we all know is going to end up getting passed anyway. And if you don't, we end up with a government shutdown, which I'm completely in disagreement with. So I would not vote. I think that federal debt is a problem, and it is an issue, and it should be addressed. But just like this shutdown proved to us last year, it is not necessary to worry about that when we focus on our daily lives. The government shut down and it did not affect a large proportion of Americans, but what does affect us is personal debt. And we're looking at $1 trillion in student loan debt just in a couple generations of people. We're looking at another $1 trillion in housing debt, mostly within another generation of people. And we're looking at about $800 billion in credit card and et cetera debt. This is personal debt. This is the debt that's going to stop Americans from making a future. We should worry about national debt, but the American people don't need the American government to continue on with our daily life, but we do need access to our money and access to a future through investment. So I would like to see that be a bigger focus of our government than the federal debt, which is always an issue, but doesn't affect us in our daily lives as much as personal debt. I would like to see serious issue reform being made and serious congressional action on personal debt is what I would focus on personally.
Thank you. Sharna.
I would not vote to shut down the government. I do think those are political games that the people just don't like. But what we need to do is be prepared and not wait till the very last minute. So we're coming up to a crisis. When we're talking about whether or not to shut down the government, that's because we're deciding whether or not to raise the debt ceiling to pay bills that we've basically already promised to pay. We need to not, it's sort of like going to the store and when the bill comes home, you're deciding whether or not to pay it. By the time you've purchased the things, you're obligated to pay it. The decision needs to be made earlier than that. We need to be much more honest about our situation, much more earnest about reducing the debt. Our national debt is a crisis. It's probably the biggest issue that we need to address right now. And I do think it affects us all personally every day. It's $450 billion or so we pay in interest every year, with historically low interest rates right now. And that equates to, if you would average it out by state, and I know it doesn't work exactly that way, $10 billion of tax money from Minnesota every year. Our Viking Stadium was $1 billion, and we're all outraged about that. It's $10 billion a year of your money that's being spent on interest. It's not going to roads and bridges, it's not going to education, it's not going to anything you might want to spend it on. We all have priorities and see needs. Interest is not it. It absolutely affects our daily lives. It precludes us from having a stronger economy, and that hurts us all. So I would not be dealing with it at the last minute. We need to be dealing with it much earlier than that so we don't have a crisis. We aren't looking to raise debt ceilings. We have the debt under control, and our economy is much stronger. So that's how I would handle that, by dealing with it much, much further in advance.
Thank you, Betty.
A big portion of why we find ourselves with these big bills are two wars, Afghanistan and Iraq, and I thank you for your service to our country, Dave. Those were wars that were put on a credit card. We asked our soldiers to sacrifice, but then we sacrificed nothing. So we should pay our bills on time and not accrue this kind of debt. I agree about, you know, this brinksmanship. It drives me crazy. We were all set to vote to, pay our bills on time. Speaker Boehner went to his caucus, the Republican caucus, and a faction within the Republican caucus didn't want to do it. And so they have a rule in the Republican caucus that they like to pass bills with a majority of the majority. Our leadership said to Speaker Boehner, when you're ready to bring that bill on the floor, we're ready to pay our bills on time. And when Speaker Boehner brought the bill to the floor, the majority of Democrats overwhelmingly all stepped up and voted to pay our bills on time. So it is very dysfunctional when the Speaker of the House, and I have great respect for John, he was the chair of the Education Committee when I was first elected. When he goes in to explain things to his caucus, tells them a shutdown wouldn't be a good idea, and they went right towards it. So I think they've learned their lesson with that. But the other thing, when we pass a bill to pay our debts, it should be a clean up or down vote. There shouldn't be, I don't want to make up anything that sounds too bizarre, but there's odd things that people will attach to bills in order to think that they can get it to vote. When you owe your bills, you pay your bills. That's what you do at your household, and that's what you should expect the federal government to do, on time.
Thank you. I'll begin the next question with Sharna. To what extent, if any, should the U.S. be involved in countering ISIS?
ISIS is a terrorist organization, no doubt. It is brutal. And we have strong concerns about ISIS's view of the United States and Americans and what they'd like to do to us. But ISIS is not able to reach us directly, and I think we have to be mindful of our national security concerns first and foremost here in the United States. ISIS is not close enough to us to dig tunnels. They can't launch a rocket over and hit us. I think in order to make sure that we are safe, we need to do it here at home first. We need to ensure that our borders are secure and our country is safe not only from ISIS, but from anywhere else. So I think our first and foremost mission critical is always domestic security, our national safety. And we can take care of that without necessarily going over there. The situation with ISIS is complex. The situation in the Middle East is complex. That's a fight that's going on, a civil war almost, if you will, between different factions of Muslims, the Sunnis and the Shiites, for 1,500 years. To think that we're going to go over there with a few bombs and fix that, I think is naive. Talking about our national debt brings up another good point here. We've authorized some spending here without figuring out how we're going to pay for it. If we're going to talk about paying our bills, before we go in further, we need to know what the costs are and what how we're going to pay for them. We're in debt over our eyeballs already. So incurring more debt for this, I don't think is a good idea without at least having a plan for how to spend it, or how to pay for it, rather. When we're talking about military intervention, too, we also need to be really clear about what our objectives are and what the mission is and how we're going to achieve it. I don't think we have that level of clarity right now anyway. We're just kind of rushing over there. With regard to the Middle East and ISIS in particular, I always say this. A friend of our friend is an enemy of our enemy is not necessarily our friend in the Middle East. So when we go after ISIS, we have to be careful about who we're supporting in that mission. And at this point, I don't think there's a place for us to go in there without supporting other enemies that also make us more at risk. So that's what I think we need to do with regard to ISIS, at least at this point.
Thank you. Betty.
Well, we need to have a couple of things happen when we get back, and one of them is we have to reauthorize a vote on the War Powers Act. We're forcing the president to function off a 13-year-old War Powers Act, which came out of the horrific attack of the World Trade Center when Al-Qaeda attacked the United States, and we found ourselves in Afghanistan, a war which I voted for. Then the Bush administration took us into Iraq, a war I didn't vote for. But Iraq under Maliki just factionalized more and more, as Sharna was saying, so it became a country that wasn't working together. And I'm going to say ISIL because ISIS is also a young girl's name. ISIL, found a foothold in the division in the Iraqi government. They're cruel. They're vicious. The humanitarian assaults, the war crimes that have been committed, the genocide that's been attempted, the international community does need to respond. We need to respond in a way, though, that has the countries in that area taking the leadership for addressing this issue that's happening right in their backyard. I do not support boots on the ground, but I do support some training and some working together. But we need to see the countries in the area step up. But it is something that we have to be concerned about because ISIL is recruiting right here in Minnesota. You've seen it in the newspapers. The youth are being courted by these groups. I just met with the U.S. attorney in my office in St. Paul, Mr. Luger, and he's with the chief of police in St. Paul. They're in Denmark now talking about this because this is a problem internationally with youth being recruited. And I was with the Somali community this weekend. They want ISIL not recruited in their community. So this is something that has a twofold presence, and it is something that we have to be concerned about here and there.
Thank you. Dave.
ISIS is bad. I mean, we can agree on that. I am not for American soldiers in Iraq again. I think it was a waste and it was wrong the first time, and I think it'll be a waste and wrong this time. We removed Saddam Hussein, who also hated terrorists. We picked one bad guy to remove out of 15 different bad guys who control those countries. And what we did was we destabilized the entire region. And now we got situations where we're talking about aiding Syria, a country 2 years ago people were talking about invading. The real answer is that we need a self-sufficient, self-sustaining energy policy in the United States, including renewable resources to be used at a majority, hopefully by 2050. Because the real answer is, as long as we go there and we send our businesses and we send our money and we invest in these countries, we support ISIS. If we buy oil from Iraq, we support ISIS. If we buy oil from Saudi Arabia, we support ISIS. And Betty took the wind out of my sails, because I completely agree. If there's no Arab states there, why are we there? If they don't even feel that their own neighborhood is worth saving, then why should we go in there and help protect it? And I realize there's a lot of minorities there, and we need to protect minorities, but why do we pick and choose? Why didn't we go into Africa several times to protect minorities? Because it wasn't economically beneficial to specific segments of our economy. So if we really focus on how do we end terrorism in the United States, we pay for our own stuff and we build our own stuff. And on a side note, I just would like to mention that since 9/10/2001, We've had more American citizens killed by our own police departments than by terrorists. And as a soldier or a veteran now, I'm not afraid of terrorists, but I am afraid of our own government over-abusing their power. Sorry.
Thank you. I'll begin the next question.
Just a clarification, and I'll speak for myself, and maybe Sharna would like to say something. At no point was I implying that we should aid Syria.
Oh, no, I didn't. Thank you.
Okay. Just wanted that cleared for the record. Thank you.
I'll begin the next question with Betty. Do you see a need for change or reform in Social Security and Medicare? If so, please explain.
Social Security and Medicare are sacred trusts. They are what has made the difference for my grandmother's generation not living in a poor farm. I remember, because it was 1965, I didn't understand it at the time. I was in fifth grade, but as I got older, I would hear my grandparents talk about Medicare and Social Security all the time. My grandmother worked at Horner Waldorf. She was the box lady. My grandfather stood on an assembly line at Seeger, which then became Whirlpool on the east side of St. Paul. And it made the difference that they knew that we're going to have health insurance, because no insurance company would cover you when you needed insurance. So that's a promise. That's a promise that we made, that seniors could retire in dignity. There are things in the Affordable Care Act that are bringing down the cost of health care to our seniors. There are things in the Affordable Care Act that are closing loopholes and fraud, waste, and abuse that will make the system work better. There's also reforms in there following a lot of the models that we have here in Minnesota, where we provide some of the best quality health care, some of the best outcomes for less money than doctors in Florida, doctors in parts of Texas. And you've read about it in the paper. We're working to implement those reforms so everybody has good quality health care. And then when it comes to Social Security, especially for women, that's the lifeblood for retirement. Because so many women who are getting ready to retire now, like my mother, were stay-at-home moms for a while. They weren't earning a wage, they didn't get a pension, and when they went back to work, they went back to work part-time. So we need to find ways in which we can strengthen and improve Social Security, and one of the ways for Social Security in particular is raising the caps.
Thank you. Dave?
Social Security is an issue. It's a big issue, especially for people retiring now, but it's a big issue for people in my generation, where we're being told we're not going to see it. And now that's an issue, because now as time's going to continue to progress, we're going to say, why do we keep paying for it? And if you get enough of us saying that, that's when things will get scary, because that's when things can change for the negative. I absolutely agree we need to maintain Social Security. We need to get together and we need to figure out how to make it work. I brought this idea up last debate. It has to be something American people need to be willing to do, but if we move the corporate tax rate to where it was in 1952, we could get Social Security through 2060. And, you know, the way I look at it is, how can we afford to pay those rates? And at that level, in 1952, we were world power then, and we're world power now, and yet today, our economy is so much bigger, and there's so much more money. Our stock market's at the highest it's ever been in the history of the world. And yet we're being constantly told that corporations can't pay for anything, that they're going to leave. But as far as I can see it, they're making money. They're making a lot of money. The average wage of a wage earner from 1992 to 2012 rose 4%. The average income of corporations in this country rose 99%. There is a way to pay for it. People have to get together and get it done. Now, I'm not sure if I even agree with bringing it out back to the 1952 levels, but that would functionally serve in saving Social Security.
Thank you. Sharna.
We need to get both Social Security and Medicare on a sustainable trajectory, and neither one of them are there right now, but there's different approaches for each. On Social Security, we have to remember what it is. It was set up, the lights went on one day, and current workers were paying for the retirees, current retirees. That's how it always was set up. And because of that, while we are not in great shape and it's not set to provide the same level of benefits as we have right now, it's not going to go bankrupt or go away. We're in a situation where in about 20 years, the surplus that we have in it right now will be gone, and we would then literally pay as you go. So current workers would pay for current retirees, and that would provide for about 75% of the benefits we have today. Now that's not ideal, and we have some time to prepare for that, but we don't have to overstate where we are with regard to that program. There are a couple of things we can do to make it stronger, though. We should invest that surplus a little better than it is right now. We're receiving almost nothing on it, and I know we don't want to go to some investment where it's a junk bond status, but there's a big range where we could actually invest that money better so we don't need more money in or to reduce payments out, but that we'd actually create more money that way. Perhaps also as important is the idea that we need a stronger economy, right? Because current workers are those who are paying into the system. So if we can have more workers with better jobs, we will take more money into the account, therefore also providing a longer sustainability for the rate of pay we have on it. We can also tinker with some things, perhaps raising the retirement age a little bit, but we need to make sure we're not pulling the rug out from seniors and they have plenty of time to adjust. With regard to Medicare, what we need to do there is what we need to do in the healthcare industry generally, which is simply make it better healthcare at less expense. We need to be innovative. We need the market involved. We need to be competitive and transparent, just like we do with healthcare costs across the board. And we can do that because plenty of other places do exactly that.
Thank you. Dave, evaluate the Affordable Care Act to date. Do you see a need for change or reform in existing law? And if so, please explain.
The Affordable Care Act has its merits. My wife has a pacemaker due to no fault of her own. We would not get insurance if it was not for the Affordable Care Act. There are several issues that I have with it, and I would like to see a state solution, because I think 300 million people in a payment plan is too many, but we could do 5 million right here in Minnesota, and the issues that affect us in Minnesota are much different than those in Florida. You know, we have a MS rate that's significantly higher than almost every southern state. In fact, I believe we have the highest MS rate in the nation. So the things that we're gonna want to invest in are gonna be different than things like Texas or Florida. So I would like to see the states take it, and my plan would be that the states could opt out of the Affordable Care Act's requirements if they had a system in place that maintained the same level of coverage. So that's what I would like to see. On some of the negatives that I have against it, it's a tax on the youth. On top of the $1 trillion you've asked us to indebt ourselves to for a education, you're asking us to now pay more by buying healthcare that we don't need and using our money that we desperately need so that the elderly and older people can have healthcare. You know, the same goes for Social Security when it comes to us. We're looking at another thing, you know, we're paying more. We're not receiving these benefits yet. The theory is we will eventually, but right now we desperately need the money. We want to invest, we want to move forward, we want to get out of our parents' basement, and here's another tax just for us. And this is, it's bothersome to me, these taxes on the youth, because in general, you know, we as Americans have been making the decisions for the past 30 years to stop paying for things, and now it's coming to a head that, oh, we need money to make stuff work, we need to pay for stuff. And now it's like, well, we don't want to pay for it. So we'll just, here's a way we can do it. We can make all the youth get health insurance. So I would like to see changes. I think that I would not vote to repeal it. So.
Okay, thank you. Sharna.
Thank you. We are better off if most people have health insurance, no doubt about that. But it needs to be affordable. Now, certainly the Obamacare rollout was rough, and some of that has caused lasting problems, but I think in the long run we'll judge the program based on its substantive, substantive problems and substantive benefits. And where are we with that? I think we see a lot of disappointment. We see people who hoped they could keep their doctors, hoped they could keep their plans, hoped costs would come down more, and they're disappointed with it. But I don't think there's going to be any waving of the magic wand and it's going to go away. What's going to happen is we'll find ways to improve it, just like we should with any other regulatory framework. If there are better ideas for making insurance more affordable, more effective, less expensive, that's what will happen. That's what needs to happen. I think it's important for people to have access to good health insurance, but I wish it wasn't mandated. I think people should have the choice to find what works best for them. What we really need with healthcare in this country is for it to be three things: portable, personal, and affordable. It doesn't need to be tied to employers and workplaces. Businesses need to focus on their business, not on healthcare. People should be able to find their own health insurance just like they find other kinds of health insurance. They should be able to move it across state lines, and it should definitely be affordable. Now, the problem with Obamacare, frankly, for me, is that it's become a bit of a distraction over here. We're not focused on the key issues in healthcare, which is what? It's the overall cost. That should have been labeled the Affordable Insurance Act. What we need is affordable healthcare. It changes the pie and how it's allocated a little bit. Some people now have insurance whereby the rest of us were paying for their care before, but it didn't bring down the overall cost of healthcare, and that's the real problem in this country. We need to shrink that pie with more market-based solutions, more transparency, more competitiveness. What I wish is one day we could have that Geico Gecko out there saying, in 15 minutes, I can save you 15% on your health insurance costs.
Thank you. Betty.
Well, 7 million Americans have access to health insurance that didn't have it before, and that's a big deal. Families would call our office quite often just at the end of their rope. They were getting ready to file bankruptcy. Why? Because they had reached a lifetime cap, because a member of the family with a family plan or an individual now found themselves with cancer or heart disease, as sounds like your wife is suffering from. Adult children couldn't be covered under their parents' plan. All those things changed because of the Affordable Care Act. Lifetime caps, gone. Co-pays for seniors to do important things like go in and have a colonoscopy, gone, so that they're taking more advantage of preventive care. Senior drug prescriptions for a lot of seniors, and I've been speaking with them because it's time for open enrollment for Part D, are saving on average $300. The donut hole that seniors used to find themselves falling into because of the flawed Medicare D plan will disappear. We can do some things better. Yes, we can. I would have liked to have seen a public plan. Some people would like to see single payer. We could put all those things back open for discussion again. But one of the things that's really in the Affordable Care Act that I touched on before is promoting best practices, which we do here in Minnesota, and where we have Minnesota hospitals and doctors and care centers coming together to even figure out how to do it better, how to give a holistic approach to patient-centered health care. So I know that there's improvements that could be made to the Affordable Care Act. It would be nice, rather than 50 votes to repeal the Affordable Care Act, we could have had some discussions on how to improve the Affordable Care Act with common sense reforms that the American people have asked us for.
Thank you. I'm going to drop the take moderator discretion and drop response time down to a minute and a half now so I can get hopefully two more questions in. I'll begin with Sharna. Sharna, what are your top three priorities if elected?
Thank you. Well, my fundamental focus is on the economy. I have a degree in economics, and I think those issues are the most important to us. So I would have to say it's the national debt, which hurts us all, as I talked about before. It's jobs. We need good jobs for everyone. And it's education. We need affordable education higher ed level, and we need better education at the K-12 level. And now that doesn't necessarily sound like a federal priority. So for me, I really am in favor of local solutions to that, getting the federal government out of the way, keeping the money in Minnesota so we have more money directly to address those issues. So it would be better and more affordable education, good jobs for everyone, a stronger economy, including reducing the national debt, which I think crushes us all and just it saddles our next generation with so much debt that they can't get out of their parents' basements.
Thank you. Betty.
Well, you just think about the economy, jobs in the economy. What are some things we can work on? Well, we can work on infrastructure, right? We can build bridges. We can replace roads. We can get rid of, we all know the pothole season's coming up. I mean, our roads and bridges need a lot of work. So we need to put together a transportation bill and a transportation package that only not only puts America back to work, but starts preparing us for the future of this country. Our grandparents did it. We need to look at a smart electrical grid with a number of increasing of electrical use, with the ability to put clean, developed energy, which will also create jobs, onto the grid. We need to have a smarter electric grid. Education's important. STEAM, you know, putting the arts in part of the whole idea of STEM, so that the creativity, the mind can be focused to be the next innovators, the next people who will make America a bright beacon for future generations. Making higher education more affordable. The federal government has a role in it, so does states. But the one thing that we need to focus on is what America does best, and that is to create jobs and to create ingenuity. So the federal government can't lead this, but it can be a partner in listening to entrepreneurs and listening to our business community on what's out there that we can do next, and then provide the infrastructure for them to build on.
Thank you. Dave.
My top three, my first would be tuition-free universities run by the states themselves. And I mentioned a couple parts of my plan to get this to be happening, which is, the first is to remove the federal government from the student loan process. The students were given a bill, and we're not given a choice into the rate, the amount of money that it costs, and we're not given a choice into the rates of our debt payments. These are two things that anybody else who invests in business has a say in, but we don't. And when it comes to education, it's still a fact that you make more money with an education than without in this economy. So you either hamstring yourself or you put yourself into serfdom. So I really want to get that fixed. And that's how this economy will really get moving. And for those of you who find the student loan forgiveness a scary concept, I believe that within 10 years through investment, anybody who lost money would have made it back tenfold. Maybe not tenfold, but you'll be making your money back by then. Other issues, congressional reform. I think Congress people should be limited to 6 years, senators 2 terms. I think that there should be a ban on becoming the member of a board of any corporation for 10 years after your congressional term, and there should be a lifetime ban on becoming a lobbyist for any congressperson. These are how we get money out of politics and people back in, the right people. And I believe that legalizing marijuana is a key, and I can't go into it any further, but. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Final question, minute and a half still, and so many other questions I just don't have time to ask. Beginning with Betty, would you favor an increase in the federal gas tax to support federal transportation funding for roads and bridges across the country, or would you suggest an alternative approach?
Well, in Minnesota, we as a state, back several years ago when we went to vote in November, we increased the gas tax because we knew we needed to do something about our roads and our bridges and our infrastructure to move it forward. But that can't be the only answer and only solution. As people drive more energy efficient cars, and as we see today's youth who are becoming today's workforce not driving as much, if that's the only thing we look at to how to keep our roads and bridges safe and working for industry and for us as individuals, we need to look at alternative ways in which people pay for the miles driven. There's all kinds of ideas out there. We could talk about that if we had a transportation bill, but we can't be afraid to discuss big ideas. We shouldn't allow the polarization that's been happening in Congress to keep us from thinking the big thoughts, dreaming the big dreams, because that's how the highway infrastructure got built in the first place, is people had a dream and a vision and they came together to figure out a way to fund it. We can do that too. And if I go back to Congress, I'm committed to improving our infrastructure, our roads, bridges, and highways.
Thank you. Dave.
I agree with Betty on this one. I think that's probably what's going to happen, is the tax will get increased, but we need to find ways to pay for it. This is one of the few things that the federal government has a constitutional obligation, so we need to make sure we live up to our constitutional obligation to the people. On top of the fact that roads are one of the best ways to keep the economy moving. We know this, so we should make sure our roads, I mean, again, this goes back to my previous comment, you know, we've spent about 30 years now cutting funding for all of these things. And now we're at this point today where it's like, oh, wow, how are we gonna pay for it all? I don't get it. Well, That's what happens when you don't pay for stuff. If I owned a house for 30 years and I kept cutting my payments on it, I would have a really bad house. And then I would be, oh geez, how am I gonna fix this? Now it's such a huge amount, I'm scared to even come up with an idea to pay for it. And I also agree with Betty. We can't be limiting ourselves. There's nothing that we can't do as a people. There's nothing that the American people can't accomplish when we really try to do it. We built a highway system across this country. We defeated the Nazis. We put a man on the moon. If I get my way, we're gonna put a man on Mars. We are a country of ideas, and we're a country that gets things done, and we're not gonna let political bickering get in the way of our future. We're not done yet as a country. We're just beginning, and I wanna keep this country going for at least 200 more years. Thank you.
Sharna.
I would not support increasing the tax on gas. We were already paying in Minnesota 47 cents on every gallon of gas at the pump. That's what the tax already is. We have a culture of overtaxing already. Last year alone, we as taxpayers wasted $450 billion paying interest on debt that this government has. If we weren't paying $450 billion, we would have money left over for these other kinds of projects, which undoubtedly are priorities. But we need to get our house in order so that we're not simply paying more and more money that's going to more and more interest. One thing that the government does that I think helps hide this culture of overtaxation is that we get nickel and dimed everywhere. I would suggest you look at this for your own selves and look at how much income tax you pay, your property tax, your sales tax, fees on utility bills. There are a lot of taxes that we're already paying. We don't need to tax the people more. What we need is a government that will prioritize and focus on roads and bridges, for example, without other projects that have bells and whistles, even train whistles. We don't need those. We need roads and bridges. And that's what we need to do, is hold our elected officials accountable for prioritizing. I think that's the most important thing we can do right now, is prioritize. So no, we don't need to raise taxes. We need to cut out unnecessary spending and debt so that we already have the money to pay for the things that we need. While Ms. McCollum was in office, the debt went from $5 to $18 trillion. At some point, enough is enough. We need to budget appropriately for our needs and not overtax our citizens.
Betty, do you want a minute?
Well, I mentioned before how we found ourselves in debt, two wars that weren't paid for, and a financial disaster like no other our generation has ever witnessed. And we're coming out of it. And just look at what's happening with the economy here in Minnesota.
At this point, we're going to begin our one and a half minute closings, and we'll begin with Dave.
I just would like to thank Representative McCollum and Sharna for giving me this privilege, and Stillwater. I really enjoy it, and I really look forward to hopefully seeing change being made. I think if you want to see real change being made, if you want to send a message to Congress that we're not going to be putting up with this kind of shenanigans anymore, make a vote for me. I'm the real voice of change. I'm the voice of the future. I think that we need to be looking forward, and there's more than just two ideas on this to fix this country. There's more than just big government, no government. That there is an in-between, and I think a lot of Americans are in that in-between. I think that, you know, when 11% of Americans think Congress is doing a good job, and yet 92% plus Congress people are going to be reelected, there's a serious issue there. And I believe the issue relies in we need congressional reform, but also that the districts are gerrymandered and that the Congress people choose their districts. Well, I want you guys to choose me. I would like my district to choose me. And I'm not choosing my district because I was born here. But I think that we can make change and we can do it. And I'm the voice of change, and that this is it. And that this is the time to do it. I appreciate the forum. And if you want to learn more about my positions, platforms, and how I'm going to get them accomplished, check me out on my website, votedavethomas.com, or my Facebook at votedavethomas. Thank you.
Thank you, Betty.
Well, thank you again to the Stillwater Gazette, to both Mr. Thomas and Ms. Walgren. Thank you for running. I think the three of us understand the time, energy, and commitment that went into this, and it's not an easy job, so thank you. I'm running for re-election to be a strong voice, to be a tough representative for Minnesota's families, communities, and businesses, to bring the federal government together in partnership in solving problems and creating opportunities. And I'll continue to do that working with my good friend, Republican Tom Cole from Oklahoma on Native American issues, Mr. Kelly from Pennsylvania, we've got the CARP language in, because I'm not just worried about it in the Mississippi, I'm worried about it on the St. Croix River. Jack Kingston, who's retiring from Georgia, who worked on cutting waste and abuse on NASCAR. So for more than a decade, I have worked to bring together local elected leaders, Democrats, Republicans, business leaders, labor, and community members. And that is how we secure the $1.2 billion in funding for the Green Line and rehabbed St. Paul's Union Depot into a modern multimodal transit hub. This week, the Green Line had over 1 million riders. The business, the economy along the Green Line is just booming. So I know there's a lot of challenges and hard work to do in Congress, and I'm looking forward to doing it. So with your support, I will keep working. I will keep trying to find the common ground to find responsible solutions that will keep the American people safe, strong, and successful. Thank you.
Thank you. Sharna.
I hear the same message from people throughout our district. Congress needs to stop fighting. But Representative McCollum promises to keep fighting. NPR described her as waging trench warfare against House Republicans. That's just not my style. We need Congress to work together for the people, not special interests, and on things that really matter to us. I'll work with everyone, Republicans, Democrats, and Independents, to get good things done. I'll do what's right for us, not what some party thinks is right. And I'll work hard, really hard, for all people and all families in our district. We, the people, are my only special interest. What matters to you matters to me. We need good jobs for everyone. Our kids need better and affordable education. And Congress, well, it needs to stop spending money it doesn't have. Congress is just piling debt on future generations, and that's not right. People say insanity is doing the same thing over and over again, but expecting different results. If we want Washington to be different, to be better, and I think we do, we have to do our part. We have to stop sending the same person there over and over. Send someone new. Send me. I'm Sharna Walgren, and I'd be honored to get your vote on November 4th. Thank you.
Thank you to the three candidates for showing. It's an honor to have you here. Also, thank you to the various media outlets that are here, including Channel 11. I appreciate that a lot. Valley Access Channels will have replays of this cable cast on Channel 16 and 15 as it gets closer to the election. On behalf of the Stillwater Gazette, Alicia Labens, the community editor, thank you for joining us. And don't forget to vote on November 4th or before via absentee ballot.
Thank you.